we have for our adaptive oblivious transfer. So our adaptive oblivious transfer and the generalization that we make in section 2 will be UC secure. So what is the UC framework? In the UC framework, we distinguish two worlds, the ideal world and the real world. So in the ideal world, the user will follow an ideal functionality where all is specified. For example, the user has to erase the random coin at this moment, he has to send the value at this moment, etc. And in the real world, in fact, the user is totally free of what he wants to do. And the protocol will be UC secure if the, an adversary can't distinguish between the ideal world and the real world. So we will allow the adversary to ask for adaptive corruption. So the adversary can ask for internal state of the user at any moment and then play his role. So it's different from the static corruption where the adversary can ask it only at the beginning and before the beginning of the protocol. So now let's talk about an existing protocol, which is called Oblivious Signature Based Envelope. So what is that? It's a two-party protocol where the server is owning some information and a recipient wants to have access to this information, and he should have access to this information only if he knows signature sigma. So we'll commit the signature sigma and the server will mask the information, and the recipient will be able to unmask this information if and only if the C was a commitment of sigma. And in fact, the server will never know if the recipient send a real commitment of sigma or not. So how to create OSBE, Oblivious Signature Based Envelope. So we need a commitment. A commitment is made of four algorithms. So two generation algorithm and one commitment algorithm and one decommitment algorithm. Here we only use the commitment algorithm because the decommitment will be implicit. So there is two property for there is two different property for a commitment. So a commitment can be extractable or a commitment can be equivocable. So a commitment is extractable if with a trapdoor we can decapsulate the commitment and see which has been committed, what has been committed. And the commitment is equivocable if we are able to give a proof that we committed a certain value that is not the one that we actually committed. So an example for each. An encryption scheme is a commitment that is extractable because knowing the decryption key, we are able to decrypt the encryption and to see what has been committed. And there is a chameleon hash function as an equivocable commitment. So a chameleon hash function is a hash function where there is an additional algorithm called collision. And it it allows the people which know the trapdoor key to find a random R prime with the message M prime such that the hash of M prime R prime is the same as the hash of MR. So it's an equivocable commitment. So second primitive that we need to achieve OSBE is smooth projective hash function, SPHF. That's function over a set X, and there is a language L that is a part of the set. So there is the first algorithm that computes the hashing key, the projection algorithm that projection key gen algorithm that computes the projection key, knowing a world and the hashing key. There is a hashing algorithm that hash the word W using the hashing key. There is a projection algorithm that project the word W with the hashing projection key and a scalar minus W. And we have the property that, in fact, if W belongs to the language and minus W is a witness of this. And then the hash value and the projected value are the same. So in fact, it's a two-way to compute the same value. So what properties do we want for SPHF? SPHF, we want it to be smooth. So if the word doesn't belong to the language, nobody can distinguish a hash value from a normal one. And we want pseudo-randomness. Without, even if the word is in the language, without knowing the witness minus W, it's hard to distinguish a hash value from a random one. So here is a little example of SPHF to well understand. So we will choose two group elements, and the language will be all the span of the vector GH, and the witness will be the discrete logarithm of a word. And we will compute the hashing and the projected this way. And you can see that H and H prime will be the same. So now we use it to create our OSB. So the server, the recipient will commit with the commitment, and the server will mask with the hash value. And here we can see the language LC sigma. It's a language of, it's a set of all commitments of the signature sigma. And if C belongs to this language, then the user is able to project C using the projection key and the witness that is the random used to commit O. And now we see how to generalize this into oblivious language-based envelop. Here, the recipient should have access to the information if and only if he knows a word in the language. So it's exactly the same, but with word. So it is clear that oblivious signature-based envelop is an oblivious language-based envelop. So the language is only the word is only a signature on a message. But oblivious transfer is no LBE too, because in fact, if we make the information to be the full database, so of each line of the database, the commitment will be, the word in the language will be the line that we request. We'll commit it, the recipient will commit it, and we will mask each line of the database. For example, DB1 will be masked by H1, and the user will be able to compute only the value HG. So he will recover only the line he requested to, and is not able to have any information about the others. And the server doesn't know which line has been requested. And there is a more complex language, and we can have, for example, conditional oblivious transfer, which is an OLBE. So now let's talk about adaptive oblivious transfer. What is to be adaptive? So we are adaptive in terms of requests. This means that, in fact, in previous work, in UC Secure previous work, each new request of the, after the first one caused a reset of the database. In this work, we have linear cost on the in the size of the database for the first request, and all other requests will be logarithmic in the size of the database. So how to do this? In fact, we will move the problem to the recipient side. We'll send the full database encrypted to the recipient, and we will do an oblivious transfer with add key, add database, the keys used to encrypt. And we will do it with IBE, and you will see further why. So this is what I actually said. So for database, we use user secret key. So doing an oblivious transfer on IBE keys is in fact a blind IBE. So here is the scheme of a protocol in the blind IBE. So what is blind IBE? Blind IBE is an IBE where, in fact, we have an additional protocol which allows the user to get the user secret key from the authority without the authority knowing which identity has been requested, and without the user, and the user is not able to have any information about the other user secret key. So it's exactly the same as doing an oblivious transfer on IBE keys. So how do we do that in the fact? So as commitment, we will use an encryption, a CCE secure encryption. We will encrypt the identity that we are looking for. It means the number of the line that we want. And we will create a language for each identity. So the first step is done by the recipient. The second phase is done by the server. And the server will compute a language for each identity, for each line, in fact. It will create the user secret key, the key needed for the SPHF, and it will create the hashing value by hashing C. And it will mask user secret key and send it to the user, and the user is able to recover only HPM ID, where ID is the identity committed. And so it recovers the user secret key ID, and he can decrypt the line of the database that he owns, and finally he has the line he requested. So in fact, it's a three-flow adaptive oblivious transfer. So the first step is that the database preparation. So the data are encrypted, the user secret key are computed, and there is creation of key to create a secure channel between the user and the server, and it disables some problem in the proof with the encryption. So the sense of the key channel will be the first flow. Then the second flow, the user will commit the line he wants, keeping the random as a witness for this language. And he will create the secure channel by And then the server will use the blind usgen algorithm to create a blind key, and he will send it to the user, and the user is able to recover the key from the blind key using his randomness. And it will recover the data. Okay, so it makes our oblivious transfer. But in fact, here the blind user usgen is not adaptive. So we will have to change the blind usgen, and why? In fact, by doing this, here we have a user secret key and hashing value for each identity. So it means for each line of the database. So in fact, we will send two times the database for each request. So it's not adaptive. Because two times, because it's the first time is the user secret key masked, and the second piece is the projection key. So we have a problem in terms of communication cost. So how to solve this? We'll solve this by fragmenting identities into bits. So we will see what it means. And it will lower the communication cost to a logarithmic cost. So we will, in fact, use iFin IBE. So iFin IBE is an IBE where the user secret key have a special form. And in fact, to compute a user secret key, we will do as for the example. So for the example, we take the identity ID 0010. And to compute the user secret key, we first take the root. And then we look at the first bit of ID. And the first bit of ID is 0. So we add usk 0. Then the second bit is 0. So we add usk 20, usk 21, usk 40. So it makes a structure between all user secret key. And it will help us. So now we have not a blind IBE, but a fragmented blind IBE with our affine IBE. And here the server will not create a language for each identity, but it will create a different language. In fact, the language LCIB, it means that the set of commitments where the if bit of the identity committed is B, is equal to B. And after it's the same thing. We mask only the fragment of a user secret key, and we add this piece Z just to disable the user to use fragment key not together. And so the Z part will just go at the end. So I'll talk about IFIN-IBE or IFIN-IBKIM. And maybe some of you think that it's something hard to have. But in fact, we have a lot of IBE that achieve this. This is the one from IQKit. Sorry. And it's quite simple because user secret key is only two group elements. An encryption is only two group elements, and decryption is only two pairing. So finally, we have seen that OSB and Oblivious Transfer are Oblivious Language-based envelope. I think IBE plus an Oblivious Transfer can create a fragmented BIBE, and a fragmented BIBE plus UC Folklore create a UC Secure Oblivious Transfer. So that's it, and thank you.
Thank you very much.
I'm curious. There was a paper by Green and Hohenberger on adaptively secure.
Yes, I'm sorry.
On adaptive, UC secure, adaptive.
Yeah, I forget to mention it because I'm confused. I was supposed to talk about it. In fact, Green make a paper, and the idea of using identity-based encryption is from it to create an adaptive reverse transfer. But this scheme was not UC secure. It was only secure in the simulatable model.
So their paper?
Their paper, yeah.
Well, it says UC secure. And also the cost.
The paper from which?
Universally years? Composable adaptive oblivious transfer.
Which is?
It's on the apron.
The 2007 or?
13. Anyway, so there is a paper like that, and also the cost is constant per query, per message. What, after a commitment to a database, the cost is constant.
It's constant, okay.
So I guess you're not aware of that paper.
Yeah. I probably read it, yes. But I don't remember here.
Okay, but your cost, you said, was logarithmic? Or?
Yep.
Okay.
Any other questions or comments? We still have a lot of time. But okay, then let's thank the speaker again. The time.